how you can make the Word of God flesh to you.
People are looking forward to having a blessed week. Yes. Okay, so we have some things to talk about. We know that sometimes things may not go as we would like for them to go. We are the people of God, and we may be praying, and we're trying to do the right thing, going to church, and we're giving our tithes, and we're helping out somebody. You know, yesterday I had the opportunity to buy lunch for somebody. It was obvious that they had some mental health issues and just got an opportunity to sneak a little Jesus in there. You understand? They're a lot more receptive to Jesus if they're full than if they're hungry or know they're about to be full. Amen? And so sometimes things don't go the way that we think they should go. Sometimes things are not the way in our lives that we want them to be. Am I talking to anybody here? Okay. So, since I'm in the right place talking to the right people, then you all understand me and we can have a good time together. So it's nice when we do our confessionals and our prayers and we come before the Lord and I thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus that you have made me the head and not the tail, above only, not beneath. And in the name of Jesus, and then you get your work evaluation. What? They said, what? They said this about me? Are you kidding me? This is not true. I'm the head. What are they talking about? And so because of work evaluation, then you don't get your raise either. What? Yeah. I was planning on that raise. I have things to do with that raise money. I already have plans for it. And then you look at it and you go, well, what am I doing wrong? You know you're being diligent on your job. You know you're being committed. You know you're being faithful. You know you're doing a better job than a lot of the other people there. But you don't want to get in pride and arrogance. But you know you're doing a better job than a lot of the other people there. And what is going on? Well, let's take a look at a couple of places in the Word of God where things like this happened. Amen? Let's turn our attention to 2 Chronicles. And this is a chapter that all of us are familiar with. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. We can start with the King James Version. let's do the first 7 verses or so initially. We'll be spending a lot of time in this chapter today. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 1. And when you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Okay. And it says, and it came to pass after this also, that the children of Moab and the children of Ammon, and with them other besides the Ammonites, came against Jehoshaphat to battle. Next verse. Then there came some that told Jehoshaphat, saying, there cometh a great multitude against thee. Now, a multitude is bad, but they were like, it's a whole bunch of them. It's a great multitude against thee from beyond the sea on this side Syria, and behold, they be with this person, which is in Gedi. And so, in other words, they were saying, this is the person and this is the company that has aligned themselves against you as your enemies. Verse 3. And Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord. Fear came, and immediately the next thing he did was to set himself to seek the Lord. And proclaimed the fast throughout all of Judah. So he was in a position of leadership. Not only did he set himself to seek the Lord, but he proclaimed a fast throughout the whole country. He's like, look, this stuff is going on. I need all of us to get together on one accord before the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 4. And Judah gathered themselves together to ask help of the Lord. Even out of the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And Jehoshaphat, verse 5, And Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court. Now see, they had fixed up some stuff around there, and he was like, this is important. We got to use the new stuff. We got to go. This is important. I need everybody's attention. And so verse 6, and said, O Lord God of our fathers, art not thou God in heaven? And rulest not thou over all the kingdoms of the heathen? And in thine hand is there not power and might, so that none is able to withstand thee? Uh-oh, sound like brothers preaching. Art not thou our God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and gavest it to the seed of Abram, thy friend, forever? Interesting. So he goes on and he says, number one, he's seeking God. Number two, he calls the whole country together to seek God. He calls them to go to the special place that had just been built, had just been decorated up all nice. And then he reminds God of his covenant. Interesting. He said, and gavest it to the seed of Abraham, thy friend, forever. Amen. Amen. Verse 8. And they dwell therein. Did you all see verse 7? Did you all see that? Let's go back to 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 7. Art not thou our God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and gavest it to the seed of Abraham, thy friend, forever? You all know why I'm doing this? Because some people are visual learners, and some people are auditory learners. And some people get it by hearing it, and some people get it by seeing it. I just want everybody to get it. Amen. Amen. I want everybody to see it. Thy friend, forever. Now the word says in Galatians 3 that we are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise, because it is by faith that we become heirs of Abraham's promises, right? So he says here that Abraham was God's friend forever, and this is a forever covenant. Therefore, there is no reason for that word to ever be taken back. Let's proceed to verse 8. And they dwelt therein, and have built thee a sanctuary then for thy name, saying, verse 9, if when evil cometh upon us, as a sword, judgment, or pestilence, or famine, we stand before this house and in thy presence, for thy name is in this house, and cry unto thee in our affliction, then thou wilt hear and help. Everybody get that? God, you said this. You said when anything is coming against us and we stand here and declare your word, you will help us. Amen. So they're reminding God of what he said. But more so what they are doing is that they are building their own faith. We know that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith comes by hearing 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 the word of God. Faith does not come by having heard the word of God. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. Present continuous, faith comes by hearing the word of God. Over and over and over. And sometimes when situations come up in people's lives and the situation hits them hard, and I know sometimes stuff comes out of the woodworks with me too, and then somebody, you know, say, yeah, I know that scripture, I know it. Mm-mm. It's not enough to know it. You got to hear it. You got to hear it over and over and over. Out of your spirit, you have to hear it. If you have, out of your mouth, you have to hear it. You have to keep hearing it. Let's turn over. Let's keep reading a little bit further. We're in verse 9. Let's look at verse 10. And we're going to read down to verse 12. And now behold, the children of Ammon and Moab. And you all know that Ruth was a Moabite, right? We see now why she left, don't we? And Mount Seir, in whom thou wouldest not let Israel invade. And when they came out of the land of Egypt, but they turned from them and destroyed them not. Next verse. Behold, I say how they reward us to come to cast us out of thy possession, which thou hast given us to inherit. Can we look at this in the Message Bible? Verses 10 and 11. And now they've come to kick us out of the country you gave us. Yeah. Verse 10 before that, can we see that one also? And now it's happened. Men from Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir have shown up. You didn't let Israel touch them when we got here at first. We detoured around them and didn't lay a hand on them. Next verse. And then he says, and now they're ready to kick us out. Wow. Now they're ready to kick us out. They're ready to kick us out. And now they've come to kick us out of the country you gave us. They showed mercy and kindness to someone. They showed grace to someone. And those same people have turned around and have come to kick them out when they could have completely destroyed them before. Not kick them out, just wipe them off the face of the earth. Not nice recompense, is it? Not lining up with the covenant, is it? You can see why they'd be upset. And maybe you work with some people like that. I was talking with Ronke earlier this week, and she was telling me about a situation that she'd gone through. Sometimes people seem like they're working with you, and actually they're working behind your back against you. And then God still, of course, being God, he still had to lay out and prepare a table before her in the presence of her enemies that were pretending to be her friends. Amen. And verse 12, oh dear God, won't you take care of them? We're helpless before this vandal horde ready to attack us. We don't know what to do. We're looking to you. Amen. Now, it's nice to have 2020 vision. And somehow, when we're looking to the Lord, we can always see it clearly. Because when we're not looking at him, it can look a bit distorted. That's right. And we can always tell where the focus is by what's coming out of someone's mouth. Amen. It's not a judgment call. We're in class together, right? We're all in school growing in this thing together. So when something comes up, oh, I can't believe this happened and that happened and that happened, reiterating all the enemy is doing. And then at the end of it, it's, but God. Yeah. Let's turn over to the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 17. We're going to come back to Chronicles later. 1 Samuel chapter 17, and let's start around verse 10. And you all know this story already. This is the story of one of my favorites, of David and Goliath. And verse 10 says, I challenge the troops of Israel this day. Give me a man. Let us fight it out together. Wow. Can we turn to it in the King James Version, please? And it says, and the Philistine said, I defy, I want you all to see that word, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. Not nice. Let's look at verse 25. And it says, and the men of Israel said, have you seen this man that has come up? Surely to defy Israel is he come up. And it shall be that the man who killeth him, the king will enrich him with great riches, and will give him his daughter, and he'll and make his father's house free in Israel. So all the debts are gone, and he gets to marry into the king's family. It's all good. Next verse. And David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, what shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine? Interesting. He wasn't looking at Goliath. He wasn't looking at how everyone else in Israel was afraid. He wasn't looking at any of that. He just said, what's the reward? What good is coming? What is the reward for doing this thing? And so he says, what shall be done to the man that killed the Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? You see, he recognized that when Goliath came against the people of Israel, he was coming against God. Because he was coming against those who represented, those who were representatives of God, or God's people. So those are the people that he was coming against. So David recognized that, and saying that he knew what the covenant was, that there was a reason why he had a reason to be bold in his stance. He says, for who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God. In other words, who is this non-covenant person making an attack against God Almighty? Can we see that in the Message Bible, please? David, who was talking to the men standing around him, asked, "What's in it for the man who kills that Philistine and gets rid of this ugly blot on Israel's honor? Who does he think he is anyway? This uncircumcised Philistine taunting the armies of God alive." He recognized something, that it didn't have anything to do with himself. It had to do with who he had a covenant with. And that is the subject of our discussion today, remembering the covenant and offering of praise. Now let's go back to 2 Chronicles again, chapter 20, and let's look at verse 13. And it says there, everyone in Judah was there, little children, wives, sons, all present and attentive to God. Can you imagine if all of America was attentive to God? Can you imagine? Let's take it a little closer to home. Can you imagine all of Tennessee being attentive to God? Let's take it a little closer. Can you imagine all of Nashville being attentive to God? Let's take it a little closer. Can you imagine all of Clarksville Highway being attentive to God? Let's take it a little closer. Can we imagine all of Word of Life, Christian Center International, the church with the best members on the face of the earth, being attentive to God? So many times other things get our attention. Something happens and the first thing we do is go to our brilliant intellect that God has blessed us all with. I've never seen so many blessed people in one church. Who are y'all people anyway? All packed together in one church? How y'all do that? Oh, that's God. Okay. We go to our natural reasoning. Oh, this happened. Okay. Da-da-da-da-da. God is just sitting there. That didn't work. Tried this over here. That didn't work. Tried something else. That didn't work. I had a situation where a business line got disconnected. Called the phone company. Why did you disconnect the phone? Oh, we don't know why we disconnected it. Oh, you had a credit. You had a credit, so you didn't owe us anything. We don't know why we disconnected it. Okay, so you disconnected, I need it turned on now. Well, no, you won't be able to get it turned on. We won't be able to turn it on for another week. What? I can't have it turned on in another week. I need it turned on today, now, as we speak. No, that's not possible. We can't do that. We have to go. So you all turned it off, correct? Yes. And you all don't know why you turned it off. I didn't authorize you to turn it off. We had credit on the account, so it shouldn't have been turned off, but you turned it off. So why is it I'm having to wait to have it turned back on? Is that craziness? Meanwhile, the clock is ticking. When you're a business owner, you pay everybody else, and then what's left over, you get paid. So every time you miss a phone call, that's somebody's paycheck that you're compensating for some other way. And these people are telling me they don't know why they turned it off and that they can't turn it on. And they're, no, there's nothing you can do. Well, can I speak to a supervisor? Well, I am a supervisor. No, you're not. I don't know what you're supervising, but. And so the Holy Spirit was like, check yourself. Had to calm myself down. Fifth gear, fourth gear, take a few breaths. Third gear, okay, Lord, help me. I don't know if I can get down a second. Help me, Jesus. Okay, calm. Okay, can I get your name, please? Thank you. Hung up the phone. Try this other line. Same thing, same information. Wasn't getting anywhere. Oh, the Holy Spirit's like, psst, psst. Oh, Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus. Can you please give me your wisdom and instruction on what I need to do? He's like, pick up the phone now, call now. Got a completely different representative, higher ranking, knew a whole lot more stuff, happened. But if I hadn't taken that moment to pray, I wonder if I would have gotten them. Maybe they would have gone on lunch and I might not have been able to get them that day. or that week or whatever. The Holy Spirit is always there, always there. And you know what? He's super smart too. He knows the things that we don't know. And sometimes you may say, why am I even saying this? This doesn't make much sense. And it's because he knows something you don't know.
Yeah.
He's trying to break the outer shell of someone so that you can reach the soft, tender core of their heart. You say, I don't know why, I just thought about that little red tricycle I used to have. I thought I was the stuff when I was on that red tricycle. What? Just talking off the top of the head. I love my little red tricycle. This is interesting you would say that. I'm having a situation now. I don't know what I'm going to get for my children for Christmas. And my little boy really wants a tricycle, and I just don't know how I'm going to do it. Holy Ghost, he got the tricycle. Don't worry about that. Now the door's been opened. We have resources we can connect you to. Boom. Don't even know why I would say that. Something so off the top of whatever. Let's go back to the Word of God. If I can have it in King James Version again, please. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 13. And all Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. And all Word of Life stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. And all of Clarksville Highway stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. All of Nashville stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. All of Tennessee stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. All of the United States of America stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, their children. All of these countries around the wall, we forget sometimes we're in international ministry. All of Ghana, all of Israel, all of Nigeria, all of Zambia, all of everywhere on the wall, still before the Lord with their little ones, their wives and their children. I wonder how much would get done if that happened one day, one time. Praise him. Let's look at verse 15. And he said, hearken ye all Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you. He got called out, didn't he? God was like, you're gonna do all this for me? I gotta speak to you directly. And this is what he says. Be not afraid nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Say it with me. For the battle is not yours, but God's. Say it with me. For the battle is not yours, but God's. Say it with me into your spirit. For the battle is not yours, but God's. Amen. Amen. Praise God. I want that to get deep down into your spirit. Let's read a little further. Excuse me. Next verse, please. Tomorrow go ye down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Ziz, and ye shall find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel. Next verse, please. Ye shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. Next verse. And Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. So let's go. Can we see this also in the Message Bible, please? The same verses. So I just want it for clarity. You know, okay. Can we go to verse 16, please? Tomorrow, you'll go after them. See, they're ready, already on their way up to the slopes of Ziz. You'll meet them at the end of the ravine near the wilderness of Jeruel. Next verse. You won't have to lift a hand in this battle. Just stand firm, Judah and Jerusalem, and watch God's saving work for you take shape. Don't be afraid, don't waver. March out boldly tomorrow. God is with you. Next verse. Then Jehoshaphat knelt down, bowing his face to the ground. All Judah and Jerusalem did the same, worshiping God. Now here we go. We have a situation where he's called his fast, and then God calls him out and speaks directly to him and tells him exactly what is going to happen. He says this is where they're going to be. They're already headed there now. You won't have to do anything. Just be there at the spot. You just show up, but you're not going to have to fight. I just want your presence there so that they see that you're there, so that they know who they came up against and they can see it with the flesh on it, because I got this. Amen. I'm going to take care of this for you. This is what he's saying. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 21. Let's go down to verses 21 and verse 22. After talking it over with the people, Jehoshaphat appointed a choir for God, dressed in holy robes. They were to march ahead of the troops, singing and give thanks to God. His love never quits.
Amen.
Can we have the next verse? As soon as they started shouting and praising God, God set ambushes against the men of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir as they were attacking Judah, and they all ended up, dead. That's not nice. They all ended up dead. Don't mess with Jesus. Don't mess with God. Can we see it in King James Version? Let's look at verse 25. Thank you. And when Jehoshaphat and his people came to take away the spoil of them, they found among them in abundance both riches and the dead bodies and precious jewels, which they stripped off for themselves, more than they could carry away. And they were 3 days in gathering of the spoil. It was so much.
Hallelujah.
And can we see it in the Message Bible? When Jehoshaphat and his people came to carry off the plunder, they found more loot than they could carry off. Equipment, clothing, valuables. It took 3 days to cart it away. Note the expression cart. You know, we tend to think that everybody was getting one or two little bracelets or jewels. It's cart. Carts, okay? The word of Minister Florence got it yesterday when we had prayer here at church, and she was talking about how the Lord daily loads us with benefits.
Amen.
And we tend to think each day we're blessed, and we are.
Amen.
But do we think that he's loaded us? He daily loads us with benefits. Is it true?
Amen.
Am I talking to the right people?
Yes.
Amen. Yes, I am. Amen. Praise God. There's something I want to share with you. And if you will oblige me just a moment, I'd like to read this story to you. Horatio G. Spafford was a successful lawyer and businessman in Chicago with a lovely family, a wife, Anna, and 5 children. However, they were not strangers to tears and tragedy. Their young son died with pneumonia in 1871. And in that same year, much of their business was lost in the Great Chicago Fire. Yet, God in his mercy and kindness allowed the business to flourish once more. On November 21st, 1873, the French ocean liner Ville du Havre was crossing the Atlantic from the US to Europe with 313 passengers on board. Among the passengers were Mrs. Spafford and their 4 daughters. Although Mr. Spafford had planned to go with his family, he found it necessary to stay in Chicago to help solve an unexpected business problem. He told his wife he would join her and the children in Europe a few days later. His plan was to take another ship. About 4 days into the crossing of the Atlantic, the Ville du Havre collided with a powerful iron-hulled Scottish ship, the Lough Erne. Suddenly, all of those on board were in grave danger. Anna hurriedly brought her four children to the deck. She knelt there with Annie, Margaret Lee, Bessie, and Tanetta and prayed that God would spare them if that could be his will, or to make them willing to endure whatever awaited them. Within approximately 12 minutes, the Ville du Havre slipped beneath the dark waters of the Atlantic, carrying with it 226 of the passengers, including the four Spafford children. A sailor, rowing a small boat over the spot where the ship went down, spotted a woman floating on a piece of the wreckage. It was Anna, still alive. He pulled her into the boat, and they were picked up by another large vessel, which 9 days later landed them in Cardiff, Wales. From there, she wired her husband a message which began, "Saved alone, what shall I do?" Mr. Spafford later framed the telegram and placed it in his office. Another of the ship's survivors, Pastor Weiss, later recalled Anna saying, "God gave me four daughters. Now they have been taken from me. Someday, I will understand why." Mr. Spafford booked passage on the next available ship and left to join his grieving wife. With the ship about 4 days out, the captain called Spafford to his cabin and told him they were over the place where his children went down. According to Bertha Spafford's Vester, a daughter born after the tragedy, Spafford wrote, "It is well with my soul while on this journey." Now, that is a song that we sing so many times, and sometimes I know when I'm going through, as you do too, and it's almost like the Holy Spirit is saying, sing that, sing it anyway, make yourself sing it. It is well, it is well, it is well with my soul. Oh, Jesus, it's not well. I know it's not well. Sing it is well, sing it is well. Say it is well. If you can't sing it yet, say it is well. It is well, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. Yes, Lord, I'm born again, spirit-filled, have a wonderful husband, fantastic church and church members. Great job. Yes, Lord, it is well. It is well. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. Lord, I don't really feel like singing that, and that really wasn't to you, so I need to do that right. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. And then you feel the engine kick in. You know how it is when you're driving your car. We drive automatics now, but you know how it is back in the stick shift days when they were much more common. You can feel it when it needs to transition to the next gear. You feel it. You feel that shift inside of you. Oh yeah, something's moving, all right. Something's changing, because we're about to see his glory up in here. And it's gonna feel like heaven on earth. Let's look at the book of Acts, chapter 16, verse 25. And we're going to read down through verse 32. "And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them." Next verse, please. "And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately," say immediately,
"immediately,
all the doors were opened," say all, "the doors were opened," and say everyone's bands were loosed. Okay, so we have immediately, Say immediately.
Immediately.
Say all.
All.
And say everyone.
Everyone.
Say immediately.
Immediately.
All the doors.
All the doors.
Okay, let's put a pause in that. And let's say everyone's.
Everyone.
Everyone's bands.
Everyone's bands.
Everyone's bands were loosed.
Everyone's bands were loosed.
Okay. So we have immediately all the doors and everyone's bands were loose. I wonder what doors need to be opened in your life. I wonder what has seemed closed to you that did not seem like a possibility in your life. And I wonder what Amran praising him will immediately open to you. You know how we Christians are. We talk about how they were praying for Peter to get out of jail and when he showed up, they didn't even believe it was him. But let's face it, that's us most of the time. We be praying, asking for something. So many times we really don't expect the immediately, do we? We don't expect immediately, but he wants us to be always expecting him to show up in some way, because it is to the degree that we believe him that he is able to manifest himself. Mm-hmm. To the degree that we believe him that he is able to manifest himself. Can you imagine? I was sitting at a place, and it's so simple. I was sitting somewhere, and there was a bunch of traffic, and there was a line of cars that wanted to get out onto the main street. So I just kind of hung back, and I'm like looking at the people over in this lane over here. Don't move. These people need to get out, so you don't move. I'm directing traffic from my car. And so I'm waiting for the people to come. But the people were not expecting anyone to let them out. So they're around fiddling with the cell phone or whatever in the car and doing whatever and cleaning out the mail or whatever. And they never looked up to see that a path had been made for them because they were not expecting it. And I wonder how many times an opportunity presents itself, but we are not expecting, so we don't see that opportunity when it presents itself. I used to play clarinet when I was in elementary school and high school. And the band, all of you know, how many people did musical instruments at some point in time in your life, any kinds of musical instruments? And so you know how it is, every now and then the band director will have you to play a line, and they want to see how you do, you know, who's going to do this, who's am I going to move seats, is this person going to become first chair, first clarinet now, or are they going to keep hanging back at third clarinet? And so one time the music director was going down the line, and I had spoken to him before, and I said, you have me back there playing second clarinet. You know I'm better than all the other second clarinets. You know I need to be playing. This was me in high school. That was the non-born again Clarissa. Okay. So you know I need to be playing first clarinet, but you have me playing second clarinet. So one day he decides to go down and have the musicians play their passage. Then we went down the clarinet line. And he came to me, and you know, I was just wasn't feeling it at that time. So I was just like, I don't feel like playing it. So he skipped over me, and he went down through whoever wanted to play it. If we didn't want to play, we didn't have to. So a couple people skipped, and a couple people played. After band that day, you know what he told me, right? He said, I was going to move you up today, but you didn't play, so you didn't give me a reason to be able to move you up. I did not qualify because I was not expecting.
Right.
Amen. Preach, Clarissa. Acts 16, verse 26, and suddenly there was a great earthquake. Immediately, all the doors, everyone's bands. I wonder what bands need to be loosed. I wonder what's holding you back, holding us back, holding anyone back that, if we get our praise on, maybe it won't be there anymore. Just maybe, if we get our praise on in a spirit of expectancy, maybe we will see some opportunity that we didn't see before. Do you know how many people drove up and down Clarksville Highway and this land was sitting here, all wonderful 20 acres, looking at it every day? Never occurred to them. They weren't expecting. They weren't seeking. They weren't looking. They were praising. Pastors driving up and down Clarksville Highway. While he was driving over to Dr. Boyd's church this morning for their service, I was talking to him on the phone. He's praying in the spirit. So his spirit was expecting something. It made his soulish realm alert, attuned. Hey, look over there. See that land? That's yours. What? I wonder how many specific instructions of what the enemy is trying to do in our lives God will specifically line out for us, like he did with Jehoshaphat. He's not a respecter of persons. Is that true?
Amen.
God is not a respecter of persons. He is a respecter of faith. He talks about those, "O ye of little faith." He told the disciples at one point in time, "How is it that you have no faith?" It wasn't even little, it just was none. And then he spoke about the woman, the widow woman, that she had great faith. I wonder if we would just put our faith out there and just believe him to be who and what he is, to recognize that he's got this. That all he's wanting us to do is to just show up and be present and believe him, and then he can do the things that he is capable of doing. And our duty after that is for us to give him the glory for him being who he is. Verse 27. And the keeper of the prison, awakening out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. Next verse. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we are all here." How nice is that? Next verse, please. And they called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas. Next verse. And brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And this shows the heart of God. He doesn't allow anything that we go through to be for naught. When we go through something, we're going through it not only for our benefit, but for the benefit of someone else. He says, "Sirs, what do I have to do to be saved?" So if somebody else got saved out of this, next verse, please. And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house." So it wasn't just for one person, although one person is good, but for all the rest of his house. His whole household got saved, and not only that whole household got saved, but all of their friends got saved, and they told the cousins and the cousins-in-laws and Uncle Bobo and them, all of them. They said, "Let me tell you the story of what happened. These people were loosed and they were still there. They could have just all ran and the guy would have killed himself and all of that." But they were submitted to authority and recognized honor, but they had expectation. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 32. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house. Look at that. You know, you always have your family members at your house, but you also have those people that are always at your house that think that they're family. And we like having them there. There's a good friend that Kobna had in elementary and high school, and I tell you, praise the Lord. He never knocked when he came in the door. He never just came in, just like the rest of the family. He just came in and opened the refrigerator, and it was his house too. So it was all that were in the house. My point is that it wasn't just his household, but it was going to have a permeating effect, a ripple effect. You understand what I'm saying? An exponential effect. Because this person will tell that person, will tell that person, will tell that person, will tell the other person. Let's turn over to our last scripture, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. And it says, "But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him that hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." Verse 10, "Which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which hath not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy." I ask that you stand to your feet, please. I like to listen to K-Love 97.1 It's my favorite radio station. It's very uplifting and encouraging. And there's a song where it talks about how many times God forgives us and how much mercy and love He has shown us. And it talks about it's more than the drops in the ocean. If you put every time God extended mercy to us, every time He extended love to us, it's more than the drops in the ocean, in all of the oceans combined. And so that same mercy, that same forgiveness, that same grace, we are to share with others. One of the stories that I heard on K-Love this week was about a young lady who was told that she didn't act like a Christian, and it was the greatest compliment she'd gotten in her life. And so there was a man that was known to be kind of wild, crazy, off the rocker, just doing any and everything that came to mind. He lived very extravagantly, very anti-God, let's put it that way. He lived very anti-God on purpose. And he was flaunting it. He was proud of it. He liked to let people know that this was his lifestyle and this is what he was doing. He was just doing everything just wild to just add up all the wild you can think about. That was him. All of them. And so there was this young lady that was in his company. I believe she worked in the housekeeping service. I'm not positive. But anyway, she was always nice to him and pleasant with him. And so he invited everyone. He was going to come over to a certain bar, and he was going to pay for drinks for everybody. And it was just going to be a lot of fun, unlimited drinks on him for everybody. And she said, probably won't be coming. I'm a Christian. And so then he said, you don't act like a Christian. And she said, what do you mean? He said, you haven't judged me. You haven't condemned me. You haven't ostracized me. You haven't looked down on me. You haven't berated me. You haven't scoffed at me. You haven't scorned me. You don't act like a Christian. And that's sad, because the greatest love that anyone should see should be coming from us. It doesn't mean we have to condone anything, you know. When they start telling the little jokes at work, and sometimes you kind of have to smile and nod and just kind of ease away. It doesn't mean you have to get all up in there and say, hey, I got one for you. Let me. I wonder if any of us ever expect that we're actually ministering to angels when we do something kind for a stranger. When you have the extra umbrella in the car, you know what I'm saying? You got three in the trunk because you keep forgetting it's in the trunk. But you got this extra one in the car and somebody's at a bus stop and it's pouring down. I wonder when we reach over and get that umbrella off the side of the door and give that to him, if we've ever given it to an angel and didn't know that that's what we were doing. I wonder how many times we have given something to a person of great resources who later came back and did something kind to us and we didn't even know they were doing it because we didn't know who we did something for. That suddenly this electric bill got paid. We didn't pay it. We know we didn't pay it. The electric company is saying, oh, someone paid that for you. You're going, praise God, was it a mix-up? Did they attribute somebody's money to the wrong account? I wonder if we recognize who we are in Christ Jesus and actually operate it like that. I wonder if we actually praised Him as we were designed to do. If the rocks were going to cry out, and next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and after that is Resurrection Sunday, the following Sunday, I should remind you all of your resurrection seed and the tremendous testimonies of things that have happened for people, people getting homes, people getting businesses, getting jobs that they've been believing for, children getting into magnet schools, all the tremendous blessings that come when people sow their resurrection seed. But I wonder if we just literally acted like we were really His. If from the inside of our being, we weren't so much concerned about measuring up in our doing, and we're just being. There's a pastor at a meeting, Vicki Jameson Peterson. Some of you know of her, woman with a powerful healing ministry and a national, international ministry. God used her mightily. And she said she saw one lady sitting in the congregation one day, and she was just glowing. The lady was just glowing. And she thought, why is this lady glowing? I gotta talk to her. God, what is this? She knew it wasn't just a great skin product. There was something causing her to almost fluoresce. So after service, she had one of the ushers go and get the lady and bring her to her. She says, I just want to know, if you don't mind, you were glowing when I looked over the congregation, and you were so brilliant. I just have to know, what is it? What is it that you do? What it is about you? And the woman said, and I quote, I just bees in God. I wonder if we would just be in God. Say it with me. I just bees in God. Oh, the peace that comes from that. All of the goal setting and drive, you know, we have some people who got some goals, some plans, and we are all with you in this ministry. But I wonder if we would just cast it, the care on Him, and just be in God. Just be in Him. You know, this is life. People tend to think that, oh, I didn't get this right, I didn't get the right, that's going wrong. So life in my life is bad because all of this stuff is wrong that's supposed to be right. Okay, life. Life does not equal perfect. Do we have that? Life does not equal that things will be perfect. I invite you to read it and tell me if there's anywhere in here that says that everything is going to be perfect in your life and wonderful every day, all the time. Anybody ever see that? It's not in there. Life is not that way. So that is an unrealistic expectation. When people get depressed and, oh my gosh, you know, this is going wrong, and anxiety, and God is just saying, just be in me. Just be in me. I got this. What I want you to do is to get in me so I can get in you. I said what He wants is for us to get in Him so that He can get in us. Or rather, more correctly, manifest the Him in us that is already there. He just wanted to be believed. With David, all of those people, all those grown men, all of those people, nobody wanted to confront Goliath. But somebody was not looking at themselves, but they were looking at who was in them. And therefore, what was in them to impact their situation. Amen? Are you with me?